There's a river flowing from the throne of God. Drink from the water right now. Oh, there's a river flowing from the throne of God. Drink from the water right now. It's a river of healing.
Just to give you a little history on our relationship with Pastor Webb here, I think it was 1999. I'm not really sure 100%, but I think it was 1999 because 2000, year 2000 was a significant year. And coming around in Pastor, or excuse me, Kevin and Annie Durant were ministering here. And as you know, we've had them pretty much every other year since we've been pastoring here. Then Pastor Roy had them come in. And so he was ministering the line there and came up to Fran and me, and just Spirit of God was just on him heavy. And he said, in essence, he said, I want you to be in Rancho Murrieta at the Fresh Oil Conference in Southern California. I believe God wants you to be there. And I know you're led by the Spirit and everything, but just does that bear witness with you? And he was just talking that way. And I said, I'll go. We'll be there. If God's saying to be there, I'm going to be there. Hallelujah. Our pastor's ministering, which is Pastor Webb, you know, and didn't know hardly much about him at that time, you know. I just knew he was the pastor, whatever. And so we went, and it was a good conference, you know, with other speakers and Pastor Dufresne ministered the word. But when Pastor Webb got up there and started ministering, speaking, I don't know if it was probably about halfway, three-fourths of the way through the message. Yeah, man, you know how something hits your spirit, you feel it on the inside? And that happened. And then the Spirit of God said, hear him. That's all he said. I knew what he meant. He said, hear him. And so when we got back home here, I said, well, I need to hear him. So I bought as many series, tape series, and they were tapes in those days. I had CDs and stuff, but they were tapes. I bought as many as I could, you know, afford at the time, which is a little under $200 worth. So that's not too bad, you know. And we just loved going up and down the coast of California. We just play those tapes, and I played them in my truck and for months and months and even years, off and on over the years. And I started giving them away, you know. But I want you to think about something. The Lord brought this to my attention. And we're talking about the spirit of faith and going to another level, you understand? And that's what God wanted. He wanted to take me and Francis and this church to another level, or many levels of faith. And it was after that that God spoke to my spirit about television. That was it. But I understood if there's a word and God gives you a word, then inside that word is all the resources, all the divine appointments, all of everything that you need to fulfill that is in that word. And you have to understand, you give God credit. You know, you need to give him credit because he's smart. You got to know this. Because I think people don't think he's that smart, you know, because God will give them something, a word to do an assignment, and it's in the natural expensive. And they don't do it. They'll pass on it when they start checking out how much it's going to cost and pass on it. And then what happens is that assignment gets transferred to someone else, and they accept the assignment. And when they accept the assignment, they accept everything, all the provision that comes with the assignment, right? Does that make sense? But anyway, you know, just connecting the dots of the past, it wasn't until after that conference and doing what God said, hear him, that's when we got the reputation of not waiting to become a big church to do what only big churches, what we think big churches do. And that's when God said, don't wait to become a big church to do big things, right? So it didn't matter what the size was. All it mattered is, did God say do it? And if he said do it, then it doesn't matter how many folks you have in your church. You understand? And that's, I caught that. Hallelujah. And then we took on all these other projects. You know what I'm talking about? Some big assignments that the Lord gave us for the size of our church. In fact, we had folks that they're not with us anymore. We've sent them out to Pioneer Works and all. And they said, you know, how do you do what you do? You know, only big churches do things like this. How do you do that, you know? And I said, well, brother, it's the word of faith. And it comes down to that. And so I said all that, and there's more. There's so many testimonies that I can share, and I'm not going to because it's not my time. It's, you came here to hear Pastor Webb, you know. But anyway, I just want you to do the same thing tonight and tomorrow. We know we're hearing Jesus because it's Jesus talking. But I want you to hear him. You hear me? Praise the Lord. Give Pastor Webb a great big hand as he comes up here and brings the word. Amen.
The Lord. Glory. Amen. Man, you could have kept going, brother. That's good preaching. I particularly like the way you say that. When you accept the assignment, then you receive all the provision that comes with it. That's good. I don't believe I've ever heard anybody say it just like that before. Now, I'm going to make it my own. Amen. Glory to God. You know, that's one of the areas of ministry that the Lord has me in. I hear good things like that, and I take them and make them great. I got that from Marilyn Hickey. Marilyn Hickey was at my church one time doing a conference. We were in the back room, the green room, and we were chatting about something, I don't know, and just conversation, and I shared something with her that the Lord had recently shared with me. She said, ooh, Scott, that's good. Now I'm going to take it and make it great. So I thought, yeah, I like that. So I'm going to take that and make it great, brother. Wonderful. Well, it's good to see you today, tonight. I trust you've had a great afternoon. I'm glad to see so many of you back. Glory to God. That's a good sign. Praise the Lord. Now, understand we don't normally have a Sunday night service. Is that correct? You know what that means. That means there's no religious devils here tonight. It's just us. See, I love these off-night services. Sunday nights when you're not normally accustomed to having one. Monday night, tomorrow night will be another one. No religious devils show up. See? They don't know we're meeting. Amen. And so we're free. We can do whatever we want to do. We can just love and flow with the Spirit of God and receive everything that he has for us. Amen. Glory to God. And so thank you again for the opportunity to be in this wonderful church. I called my wife today and told her what a great place this was. I knew it was going to be. And you've been prayed for. This church has been prayed for. These meetings have been prayed for. And I just want to say something too, just between us, okay? Because I appreciate Pastor sharing that about the relationship. I know you don't know me per se, other than just your acquaintance with me this morning. Pastor's listened to a lot of my stuff over the years, but you know, one of the areas of assignment that I have in these last days is helping your church. And I'm here to help your church. I'm not here just to you know, have a meeting and then move on to another meeting. I'm here to help your church. And I'm happy. I'm honored to be used like that. And I just believe together we'll go further than we would apart. Glory to God. And that doesn't mean that you know, I'm going to come in here with some great something that you don't have. It just means that the Lord knows how to team us up and cause us to work together. And I'm just wondering why it took you so long to invite me if you've been... Glory to God. But it's not like I'm holding unforgiveness or anything. I'm just wondering. Praise the Lord. All right, y'all ready to get into the Word tonight? Go with me to the book of Ephesians. This time go to the 6th chapter. We're going to start here, launch out from this particular passage. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Familiar passage of Scripture to you, I'm sure. He said, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Everybody say, be strong. Glory to God. Now see, that's instructions. That's a commandment. Be strong. Not be strong though, just in your own strength. Don't try to work up courage. Don't gut it out, but be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Now notice that word finally. He's summing up, the Apostle Paul summing up this great letter. And I think the letter to the Ephesian church is one of the richest in Revelation. One of the strongest, especially when it comes to giving us information and revelation about our authority as believers. You remember this morning we were looking at the second chapter, and we talked about how that we God, who is rich in love, for his great love wherewith he loved us, has raised us up and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ, to the end that he should just show us off and show to us the riches of his grace. Well, the thought of that had actually started back in Ephesians chapter 1, where it talked about where Paul was praying for the church, excuse me, and he prayed that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened so that they would know, among other things, what the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe was or is, and how that he has raised us and seated, when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. Now, when we read in Ephesians 2 that we're seated with him, understand that's the same seat. And as I believe it was referenced earlier in this service, that's far above all principality and power and might and dominion. Every name that's named, not only in this world, but the worlds that is to come. Now, what this is a reference to is the authority of the believer. The believer has been given authority, or you could say it like this, authority has been restored. Adam was given authority in the beginning. Satan deceived him and tricked him out of it. And for thousands of years, man operated under the thumb of Satan. But Jesus restored that authority. The Bible tells us that he stripped him of the keys and in the book of Revelation. And that is, again, is a reference to authority. The guy with the keys to this building is the one who has authority here, right? And so he has restored that authority to us. We're in a season of restoration. And everything that I'm talking about, both this morning, tonight, tomorrow night, is all kind of centered around, either directly or indirectly, and focused on the restoration, the season of restoration that we're in. I'm not just sharing messages with you and, you know, this and that. It's thematic. We're on the trail of restoration. God has declared to us a season of restoration. Now, it's important that we understand that this seat that Jesus has been seated in at the right hand of the Father, and therefore the seat that we have been seated in, this seat of authority, is the place from which we should operate and do everything that we do. This is the seat from which we pray. You know, Pastor and I were talking earlier about some things we've seen over the years, and there were people that in times past, these kind of fads come through the church, these things, and, you know, people get kind of excited about them. And there was a season where people were renting airplanes or renting the top floor of a building to go up there and pray because, you know, there's the principalities and powers and wicked spirits in heavenly places. We're going to get up there and deal with it. The first chapter of Ephesians tells us we are above them already. It's not a geographic location. It's an authority location. We have been seated, and all these beings are under our feet. So you're already above them. Now, when you start thinking that way, we got to get an airplane to get above them, what you've done is you've come out of your seat. If you got to find some other way to get above them, then you've stepped out of your seat. When God seated Jesus there, he never got up. Right. And when the Lord seated you in him, you're not supposed to get up either. But sadly, many people do. They're operating from some other place. No, everything you do ought to be done from that seat of authority. Everything you do in life, your prayer life, should be prayed from that seat of authority. So when we read what we're about to read, understand that Ephesians chapter 1, he's laid the groundwork. Ephesians chapter 2, he's laid the groundwork. We're seated in that place. So when he tells us be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, this is one way you apply this. You pray from that seat. I got to tell you, the view is different from up here. You mentioned Brother Dufresne. A number of years ago, we were both out in Southern California. And his church and home was there in Murrieta. I have a place in Temecula, which is just south, you know, between Murrieta and San Diego. And so he had a meeting in, I think it was, which one's further north, Merced or Modesto? Modesto's further north? Okay, he had a meeting in Modesto, and I had a meeting in Merced on a Wednesday night. He was going to fly his plane up there and preach and come back and sleep in his own bed. So we were talking about it, found out we had these meetings together. I said, well, hey, Doc, how about dropping me off in Merced? Let me preach. You fly to Modesto, you preach, then you come back, pick me up, and we'll both sleep in our own beds. He said, hey, no problem, because he and I were in covenant with one another, and that's what we did. You know, we helped each other out. So now, as I said this morning, I'm a pilot, and I right now I'm between airplanes. I'm believing God for my next jet, but I normally, even the plane that he had, I've got probably 1,000 hours in that particular plane. And normally I'm up front flying it. But this particular night, his pilot was up front and I'm sitting in the back. He and I are sitting in the cabin. Well, we're climbing out probably, 15, 18,000 feet. We're headed up for the flight levels and I'm just looking out the window, enjoying the view. We're chatting back there and I said, man, everything sure does look small from up here, doesn't it? He said, yeah, it sure does. He said, boy, the bill collectors can't get you up here, can they? I said, no, they can't. Then it reminded me of something the Lord had shared with me some years before. I said, it's like God told me, when you sit where God sits, you'll see what God sees. And I mean, the Spirit of God fell on us in the cabin of that airplane, and Brother Ed just jumped up and began to dance around the inside of that cabin like that. You know, he was a little short fella anyway, and he just dancing around. And we shouted and praised the Lord. And this is the view that God wants you to have. He wants you sitting where he sits. Now you understand you have a physical body, but spiritually you have a seat of authority. And so when you're dealing with life, you should deal with it from that seat of authority. When you're praying, you know, if I were to ask the average church member, show me the devil. Where's the devil? Where, you know, we spirits and principalities and all that, point to them. A lot of people would go, very few would go like that. But the reality is, that's where they are. They're under our feet. And we should meditate in this and get a revelation of this so that it becomes just normal to us that we operate from this seat of authority. So when he says, finally now, keep in mind, he's summing things up that he's already said. And if he's like you and me, he's hitting the high spot, wanting to emphasize the most important point and give them the takeaway, if you will, as he concludes his letter. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places, or wicked spirits in high places. Verse 13, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Now again, he's already established in Ephesians 1 and Ephesians 2 both Jesus' position and superiority and authority over the devil. And in chapter 2, he has established us in that same spot. Jesus is the head, we're the body. We have the same authority, we have the same seat. You understand, there's a seat at the right hand of the Father. There's only one. There's not a billion seats, one for each Christian out there beside. There is one. Who's seated there? Jesus is. Who else? I am. He is and I am. I'm seated in that same seat. We can say we are. I understand that. But you need to make it personal. Jesus is and I am. Jesus and I occupy the same seat. Otherwise, you'll kind of hide in the crowd. You know. Understand you have that authority. So when Jesus tells us by the Holy Ghost here, through Paul in Ephesians 6, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against these principalities and powers. He's already established our position above them. He's already told us we're seated and they're under our feet. Now, I looked at this one time and I questioned the Lord. I said, Lord, why didn't you say we don't wrestle against flesh and blood? Why didn't you just say our battle is against the devil? And of course, the Lord instantly answered me and said, because most of the time, the way that these enemies will come at you is through flesh and blood. And so he wants us to understand, don't make the mistake of getting in flesh and blood fights. Exercise and walk in your authority and dominion over the devil. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. Praise God. And so Paul said here to pray with him and pray for him. Now, if we have this authority, if we're already seated in this place, why pray? Because once again, it's not just always about you individually. It's about the work of God. And you need to understand that, you know, when we talk about restoration and all of the abundant life and everything God has for you and all he wants to do for you and all his gracious purchase for you, that's all true. But also accept your assignment as a part of God's work. And recognize that it doesn't stop with you. It's not supposed to stop with you. You have a responsibility for enlarging the kingdom of God and doing the work that God has called us to do. And prayer is working together with God to establish his will in the earth. Some things just don't happen unless we pray. Is it because it's not God's will? No, absolutely it's God's will. But they still don't happen unless we pray. Somebody said, well, I believe if it's God's will, it'll happen. Well, then why did Jesus say, thy will be done? Why did he say, pray this way, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven? If it's automatic, then why did Jesus tell us to pray that? If it's the will of God in heaven and the will of God in earth, won't it automatically happen? No. It's not automatic. Because again, there is resistance to these things. Now, Satan's under our feet, but that doesn't mean he just takes it lying down. He will endeavor to assert himself into the affairs of men. And that's why you have to learn to push back. Having done all, you stand. Notice there's two things it says you do. You stand and you withstand. Now, stand means plant yourself and don't be moved. But withstand means push back. And we push back in prayer. The old timers knew this. They understood this. Prayer. Now, I know this church is a praying church, and this is the reason that the Lord is leading me in this direction to talk to you about this tonight, because this is all part and parcel of restoration. So, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Now, notice that, be strong. Now, turn with me back over to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 11. And while you're turning there, I'll remind you of something that I'm sure many, if not most of you, are aware of. I know Pastor knows this. Back during the, 80s, late 80s, early 90s, long in there, it kind of became trendy for ministers, you know, who stood at the forefront of the camp and the leaders in the body of Christ to have a word for the upcoming year. Now, certainly God does that because the Lord gave me a word last year, but I wasn't looking for it. It just came. And the Lord gave me an assignment with it. But there were a number of ministers who would have a word for the upcoming year. I remember Brother Sumrall was one of those guys, and he wrote several books, several successive years, What the Lord's Saying About 1988, 89, 90, so on. And somebody asked Brother Hagin one time, he said, what's the Lord saying to you about what he wants to do next year? Now, Brother Hagin told all this publicly, so I'm just quoting or you know, referring to what I heard him say publicly. He said, somebody asked me, what's the Lord saying to you? What does he want to do next year? And I got to thinking about it and thought, well, you know, that's a good question. So I went to the Lord and I asked him, Lord, what do you want to do next year? And he said, the Lord answered me this way. He said, I want to do the same thing next year that I've always wanted to do. I want to raise up strong local churches that will preach the word and flow with the Spirit. Now, that little nugget has gone around the world multiple times, and the phrase has been coined, and all of us have embraced the understanding that what God wants in His churches are churches that preach the word and flow with the Spirit. And so in one form or another, that has been, you know, shared many times over. We're a church of the Spirit and the Word. Without the Word, you know, you get flaky. Without the Spirit, you dry up. So we're Word and Spirit, said and so on. But I'll just tell you, when I first heard him say that, you know how the Holy Ghost will punch a word in your heart when you hear something? The word that he punched with me was the word strong. I heard the Spirit in the Word part, and I understood that, and I still believe it. But the Lord said this to me. He emphasized that word strong. He said, I want to raise up strong local churches that preach the Word and flow with the Spirit. So I heard that, and I just hid that in my heart. And then over the years, I began to see exactly what he was talking about. Be strong in the Lord, the Scripture says, and in the power of his might. Now, when you go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we find the instructions that Paul gave us by the Holy Ghost for the communion table. And he talks about the blood, and he talks about the body, and how the bread and the wine are typical of it. And it says he's giving instructions there. And then he concludes these instructions. Let's just start here in verse 28. He says, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Verse 30, for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. Now, we'll just stop there for time's sake. That goes far enough, because what I want you to see is verse 30, where he says, for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Now, as I know, I'm sure you know, because this is a church that's well taught, I can tell, though this is my first day here, I can tell this is a church that knows the Word. You know, you've heard that this is really the only reason given in the New Testament for weakness, sickness, and premature death in the body of Christ. Now, I didn't say, and neither did he say, that it was the only reason. I'm saying it's the only reason that the New Testament gives us. And what is that reason? Not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause, many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. That means many have died. And the implication there is they died before they should have. And so it's a very important thing. I mean, it's a point that we should take very seriously. If this is the cause that he chose to point out for weakness, sickness, and death, then let's take a look at it. And what is that cause? Not discerning the Lord's body. Well, now, I've always understood this and seen this on several different levels. One level, of course, being the fact that you've got to believe that Jesus bore your sicknesses and disease. Himself took our sicknesses in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Jesus bore, in other words, healing for the physical body was part of the package. It was part of the package of redemption.
Thank you for watching Demonstrations of Faith, a ministry outreach of Faith Alive Christian Center in Reno, Nevada. If you don't have a home church, we invite you to come and connect with us. We have ministry for the entire family on Sundays at 9 a.m. and 10:30 a.m. and Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. Our Connect Youth Ministry meets on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. Childcare is available for all services. Our location is 120 Hubbard Way, half block east of the Peppermill in Reno. You can find us online at faithalive.net or by searching for Faith Alive at all social media outlets. Thanks for watching, and join us next week for Demonstrations of Faith.
And it's flowing to me. It's holding.